All right, good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? All right, a few of you are still figuring it out. That's okay, take your time. We're glad to have you this morning at Harrisville Baptist Church, and we're excited this morning that we get to do one of the greatest things we get to do in the lives of believers and the life of a church, and that is to celebrate baptism, believer's baptism, with people who have come, given their life to Christ, and now are following Him in obedience by coming here and following Jesus in these waters. There's a few things about the waters of baptism. First off, nothing magic up here. It's not holy water. It's Harrisville tap water. It just doesn't come anywhere but from this tap right here to my left, your right. It's Harrisville tap water. The power part of it has already been done. Jesus has saved the three that have come this morning weeks ago. And they have been bound for heaven since that time. Today is not their salvation. Today is their step, one of many steps, of obedience to Jesus Christ. Why do we baptize with water? One, because Jesus was baptized in water. And two, because He tells us to do likewise. And so this morning we celebrate a great picture of what Christ has already done in the hearts of these three that come this morning. We celebrate as they come into this water, it represents their life before they gave their life to Christ. All the things they thought, all the things they believed, all the things they did, all the things they didn't do. And then as they stand here and make their profession saying that they have given their life to Christ, we lower them into the water fully. And that symbolizes, just like Christ died on the cross for us, it symbolizes their death to their old self. Now that sounds strange in 2021, but it's exactly what happens when we tell Jesus, please be my Savior. We die to our old self. And then we come up out of the water just like He came up out of the grave as a picture of Him raising us in newness of life. That He has taken us from death in Christ, or death in sin, to life in Christ. And that we show that right here. And then the last part's so very important. As they leave out of these waters, that is the picture of what their life is going from here forward. And that is to walk in the direction, the guidance, and the power that comes from their faith in Christ and His work in their life through the Holy Spirit. So this morning, we're so glad that you're here to celebrate that with these three and with us as a church family. Let's pray together before we get started. Father in heaven, we are so thankful, Lord, for Your love for us. It's through Your love for us that we can know, first off, that we need a Savior, and second off, that You have provided a Savior for us in Jesus. Lord God, thank You that these three that have come today, Father, have done that. They've known that they needed a Savior. They've known that Jesus is the one to save them and the only one who can, and they've put their faith in Him. Lord God, we celebrate that with them. We rejoice as the angels rejoice in heaven when that happened. Lord, today we thank You that we can celebrate this sign of obedience, Father. And Lord, we pray that it would be symbolic and representative of what happens in all of our lives as Christians, especially in the lives of these three today. So Lord God, let what we do be glorifying to You. Father, we thank You for the blessing we get out of it as we not only celebrate baptism, but as we worship You throughout this time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's not a whole lot better than a parent getting to baptize their child. And we get to do that twice today, so that's even more exciting. But I'm going to ask Steele Cockrell, our associate pastor, you know Steele, if he'll come. Now, there's two of us in this water, so you guys might get a little wet before it's all over with. Steele has got the great honor and privilege of baptizing his son, Logan. And so, Steele, I'm going to turn it over to you. I'm just going to hold your mic.
Praying for this for a long time. I was kind of hoping about 3 years ago so he would be about right here and not right here. You good? I'm trying not to make you less nervous. Logan, do you know without a shadow of a doubt where you're going to go when you die?
Yes, sir.
Where?
Heaven.
With who?
Jesus.
All right. Come stand right here. Get your hands out of your pocket. Don't do like Brock and Scoot. Do this. All right. Woo! All right. Can't even see me. Hey, Logan, my son and my brother, I love you. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Bear with baptism, and newness of life.
Doesn't get much better than that, folks. We had a time this summer where the Lord was working pretty mightily in our students. We had a lot of, many of you remember, you were here that Sunday morning when some of the ones who had given their life to Christ at camp came and made their profession of faith public. They stepped forward in our service. And what was even more glorious than that was God added to that number that day. There were some even in that service who gave their life to Christ and some who have already followed through with baptism. And we couldn't be more happy about that. I mean, we could not be more excited that God is working in the lives of people, especially in the lives of teenagers. You and I all know how tough it is these days to be a teenager. There's a lot of things that teenagers face today that we didn't face when we were teenagers. There's a lot of things going on that make it harder for them to live out their faith, harder for them to share their faith, and harder for them to be able to communicate the things that they believe because of all the world around us. But Christ is still on the move. He still is saving teenagers. He still is using teenagers to draw other people their age and older to salvation as well. And we're so excited for Logan. We're also excited for these next two that will come. I get the pretty ones, right? So I get to do the ladies. But so our next one is Anna Lauren Langston. Anna Lauren started coming to Harrisville Church here back around VBS and has become just a very important part of our church, a very important part of our youth group, and it's just always good to see this great smile come in the door, and she always speaks and always is so polite and respectful. So her family, we're so thankful for y'all and thankful for the young lady that you're raising. We're thankful that she has given her life to Christ that day, right, when that Sunday morning, and that she is now coming to follow through and follow him in obedience and baptism. Anna Lauren, do you know that you've given your life to Christ? And have you committed your life to follow him wherever he'll lead? And it's my privilege, my pleasure, to baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And our last one this morning is the one that needs to be held under the longest. No, I'm just kidding. Mallory Mayfield's coming today. Mallory's testimony up to this point in her life is like a lot of ours. A few years ago, when we were in Louisiana, she gave her life to Christ. And she prayed, and she made it public, and she followed through in baptism then. And I had to go up to camp this summer a little bit late. We had some things going on and some ministry to do here. So I got there, got out of the car, and she came up with tears in her eyes and just grabbed a hold of me. I thought, what has Steele done to y'all, right? And this is not the way camp's supposed to go at all. But she said, I got saved tonight. And so, you know, sometimes we think, oh, well, you've already done that. Well, no, this is part for each of us to be honest, to search our hearts and let God search our hearts each and every time that we think of him to be sure. And that's what I get to celebrate today with Mallory, and we've been celebrating since that day in July, is that she's sure. She knows. And we said, well, you've been baptized. Do you want to be baptized again? She said, absolutely. I said, okay, I think I can make it through it maybe one more time. Mallory, are you sure that you've given your life to Jesus? Yes. And have you committed to follow him wherever he guides you? Yes. And it's my pleasure to baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Love you, baby.
I think she brought that bug with her in here. We are thankful that you were here to celebrate this. Families of those who were baptized today, it is a great testimony to who God has made you to be in that you have ministered to these young folks to be who they are becoming. And it's so important that we understand that we do this together. Church family, I know you're excited today. I know you've been excited leading up to this point, just as I have been. So thankful to be able to continue to serve God. The question comes to each of us today. Are you sure? Are we sure? Do we know beyond the shadow of a doubt that we have put our faith fully, squarely in the person of Jesus Christ, who has and always will be God, came and stepped into life, into human history, put on skin, put on flesh, and became also 100% man, that he would be able to go to the cross and be that one necessary, one sufficient sacrifice for all of our sins. And he didn't stay dead. He gave his life on that cross, but on the third day he rose again, showing his power over even the things we fear the most. If you know that you've done that, praise God. Let's serve him together in whatever he allows us to do. If today, during this time or the moments going forward in this service, God says to you, it's your turn. It's your time. Maybe you thought you had been saved. Maybe you're like Mallory and so many of the rest of us. You thought you had been saved, but he says to you today, you need to be sure. Then don't wait another second. Let it be today. Let's follow God. Let's worship him together today. And we're going to do it a little different because Steele's still getting a chance to get changed and come out to lead our music. We're going to get down to the Baptist business first. We're going to take up the offering first. Is that okay with you guys? Good, because that's what's about to happen. We're going to take up our offering, then we're so thankful to have Eric Deere come and lead us in a song, and hopefully that'll give Steele a chance to get back out. If not, Eric's going to tell a few jokes, and we're going to have a great time together. So no pressure, Eric. God bless you. Let's have a great time worshiping together this morning.
Thank you. I feel the touch of hands so kind and tender. They're leading me in paths that I must trod. I'll have no fear when Jesus walks beside me, for I'm sheltered in the arms of God. So let the storms rage high, the dark clouds rise, they won't worry me, for I'm sheltered safe within the arms of God. He walks with me, and all of earth can harm me. Sheltered safe within the arms of God.
Amen. Now I know why I don't follow Eric. Good job, brother. I appreciate y'all. Ooh, we can go home now, can't we? I'm wore out. Got my weekly bath and everything. Thank you, Harrisville. All righty. I'm going to ask if y'all would please stand. Logan, come on. Trials all dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But He'll guide us with His eyes, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by. By and by, Lord, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathering home, we will tell the story of how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Temptation's hidden snares often take us unaware, and our hearts are made to bleed for some thoughtless word or deed. And we wonder why the test when we try to do our best, but we'll understand it better by and by. By and by, Lord, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathering home, we will tell the story how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Do that chorus again. By and by, Lord, when the morning comes, when all the saints of God are gathering home, we will tell the story of how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Amen. Give God a hand. Y'all may be seated. I am thine, O Lord. I have heard thy voice, and it told thy love to me. But I long to rise in the arms of faith and be closer drawn to thee. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Well, there are depths of love that I cannot know till I cross that narrow sea. There are heights of joy that I may not reach till I rest in peace with thee. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Do that chorus again. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, 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 blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. Amen. I love technology. God is good, amen? All right. Mm-hmm. over the mountains and the seas. Your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the seas, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 And oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know. When the world has seen the light, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. And I could sing of your love forever. 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 If y'all would, please stand. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. And all of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, let it never cease to worship you. Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to that promise I have in you. Savior, Lord, there is none like you. In all of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to our King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your wonderful name. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. Forever I love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to that promise I have. Oh, nothing compares to that promise I have. Oh, nothing compares to that promise I have in you. Amen. Y'all may be seated. Who's praying? Okay, there you go. All right, okay.
Amen. And as Ken prayed just a moment ago, many of you probably already know, but Miss Betty Welch, who is Missy Welch Westmoreland's mama, and of course related to several folks here in our community, they've got a big family. But Miss Betty yesterday took a turn for the worse, so they're not really expecting her to make it very much longer. So continue to pray for Miss Betty. She's been on our prayer list. She's been under hospice care for about a year now, so it's been a very long journey for her family and for her. We were able to spend some time with them a good bit last night, and just heard from Missy this morning. Said she's still hanging on, but it's looking worse and worse. So the good news is for her, for Miss Betty, because of her faith in Christ, it's looking better and better. Even though the suffering is here now, her suffering is going to be over with very shortly, especially in the scheme of eternity. And her celebration for all of eternity will begin. So pray for Miss Betty, pray for Mr. Randy, for Missy, for her two sisters, as well as for Charlie and Mason and Levi, the whole family there, as they go through this very tough time in the loss of their loved one. Well, we continue into a series called The Time of the Judges, talking about the book of Judges, and there's all kinds of things to talk about in the book of Judges, and today it's going to get a little action movie oriented before it's all over with, maybe even a little bit racy from time to time. But the story of Judges is simply this. It's a story of God delivering his people when they're oppressed by evil people. Kind of like Texas A&M beating Alabama yesterday. You know what I'm talking about? It's kind of the same idea. No, it's not the same idea. Unless you really don't like Alabama, and then it's close. It's close. But what God continues to do is be faithful and merciful to his people. And we talked about last week as we introduced the series how there's this cycle that goes on in the life of the people of Israel, and it continues on even to the people who are in Christ today. And even if we're honest, it happens in our life more often than we'd like to admit as well. And that cycle is this, is that that we are comfortable with God, we are in a good relationship with God, we're doing the things that we're supposed to do, and all things are going great, we're happy about it, we're joyful, we have that joy that comes from following the Lord, and then over time we kind of get a little complacent. We start to slack off on some of the spiritual disciplines, we start to pray a little less, read our scripture a little less, come to church a little less, serve a little less, and before too long we find ourselves really kind of distant. And maybe it's distant in physical location. Maybe it's distant in our mind. Sometimes it's distant in our hearts. And in those times, we start to lose the perspective that God gives us in salvation. And so we start to see things a different way. And we start to see all the things that go on in this world in a much more negative light. And inevitably, we begin to suffer. And so that's exactly what would happen with the people of Israel. They'd begin to suffer. And God would even use that suffering to bring them back to Him. And so they would cry, they would, as Scripture tells us, they would groan to God to save them from this struggle, from the trouble that they're in. And God was faithful, and He would come, and He would rescue them. In the book of Judges, He would raise up what they would call a judge. Not so much a judge with a gavel and a robe, usually a military type of judge. One that would help in the governing of the people, but would help to deliver them from this oppression, whoever the oppressors might have been from the surrounding area. And God would rescue him. He'd raise up that judge. He'd bring victory through that judge. And for all the days of that judge's life, the people of Israel would continue to live at peace. And then the judge would die. And they'd get complacent. And then all of a sudden, the cycle would start again. And that goes on several times through the book of Judges and several times through the kings that would come after the judges. And even, as I said, on into our lives today. The good news is that the same God that continued to deliver the Israelites, continue to do miraculous things, powerful things, supernatural things, He still does those same things today. And that's why we study the book of Judges. That's why we preach from the book of Judges, because it's so important to see, even in our rebellion, that God is merciful and God is faithful and loyal to come and do what He is doing that is the most important thing, and that is glorifying Himself. And we are thankful. I hope we're thankful that part of Him glorifying Himself is redeeming His creation, rescuing His creation, taking His creation from rebellion and bringing us back to good again. And that is what we see playing out. In Judges chapter 3, beginning with verse 7, we read, it says, "The Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They fought the Lord their God," or excuse me, "they forgot the Lord their God and served the Baals and the Asherahs. The anger of the Lord burned against Israel so that He sold them into the hands of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram-Naharaim, to whom the Israelites were subject for 8 years. But when they cried out to the Lord, He raised up for them a deliverer, Othniel, son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, who saved them. And the Spirit of the Lord came on him, so that he became Israel's judge and went to war. And the Lord gave Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram, into the hands of Othniel, who overpowered him. So the land had peace for 40 years, until Othniel, son of Kenaz, died." We see here in chapter 3 of Judges, we see this cycle, or one episode, or one rotation of this cycle play out. We see it in this first judge, Othniel, who has come. We recognize him as being related to Caleb, who was one of the spies who was sent into the land of Israel before the people had come into it. And he was one of the two spies that said, "Hey, we can do this because God's on our side," even though the other 10 spies said, "Oh no, these people are too big, they're too strong, we can't do it." So he comes from a good family. He comes from a strong line, a strong belief in God. Now, was Othniel perfect? Well, we don't get that information. Likely not. Likely he was just like a lot of the rest of the Israelites. But nonetheless, the people of Israel started to do other things. The people of Israel started to wander in what they and who they worshiped. The Baals and the Asherahs that we mentioned there in verse 7, those are other gods. They're gods that were represented amongst the people in the promised land before the people of Israel step into it and claim it in the name of the Lord and under His promise. So here they are, these other gods. We read in the first two chapters of Judges, as well as through Joshua, how the people of Israel have been commanded to drive these people out, as well as destroy their worship areas and their acts of worship, and yet they haven't. And that's why these gods, as we read last week, God said, "I'll let them be a trap and a snare to you," and that's exactly what's happened here. They've left that worship of these pagan gods in and alongside the worship of the one true God, And what's happened is they've gotten confused. They've gotten distracted. They've become complacent. And as we read through just what we just read, we see that this brought about a time where they forgot about the Lord their God and went fully over, many of them, to worshiping these pagan gods. Well, obviously that's a problem. They wouldn't even be in the land without the one true God, the God of Israel. They wouldn't even be there. They wouldn't have been taken out of slavery in Egypt. They wouldn't have been brought through the desert all over generations to get to this point. They wouldn't have had the generation of time between the time they stepped into the promised land and now to be able to even have the opportunity to have their own place, their own land, their own freedom. They wouldn't even have that chance without the God of Israel. And yet, how quickly they forget. How quickly they jump into other gods. How quickly they jump into a situation where they're looking at the Baals and the Asherahs and the other ones that were represented. Those weren't all of them. There were many more. And they looked at them for fertility, and they looked at them for great crops, and they looked at them for favor and blessing and all the things that God was already giving them. But they got complacent. And in verse 8 we see God's response. Says the anger of the Lord burned against Israel so that he sold them into the hands of this oppressive king, this oppressive nation, one that was not of the people of God. And what we see here, first off, is that our disobedience does anger the Lord. We can't make any mistake in 2021 under the thoughts of, yes, God does love us, and he does. We love some people too, but does that keep us from ever getting angry with them? Be careful how you answer that. Lightning does strike indoors. Yeah, I mean, we still get angry at the people we love, and they sure get angry at us, right? The Lord's anger is his first response. It offends the Lord when the people he has given everything to reject him. Thankfully, though, the Lord is perfect in his anger. And even though it arises his anger, he doesn't punish them to destroy. He punishes them to redeem. And that's exactly what he does in this cycle that's playing out right here. He sells them, basically gives them over into the hands of this foreign king who comes in. And it says the Israelites, the last part of verse 8, the Israelites were subject for 8 years to this evil king. They were not living in the freedom that God had for them. They were living under oppression. And for 8 years, now 8 years in the scheme of generations may not seem like a long time, but 8 years is a long time. 8 years ago, my college football team won a national championship. And you would not know that by right now if you know my college football team. I'll let you look it up later on. 8 years is a long time. Some of you wives out there, if you've been married at least 8 years to your husband, you understand 8 years is a long time. They were under this king for 8 years. And in the midst of that, they cried out to the Lord. Many of them were still faithful. Many of them were not. Many of them, it would have been easy to say, well, they're the reason we're in this predicament. They're the reason we're suffering this way. But instead, they cried out as they should in times of oppression. They remembered that God said he would be with them, and they cried out to God. And God was faithful to provide. And what we see here in this passage that we've read so far this morning, we see that God provides, and we must respond. God gives us everything Scripture tells us that we need for life and godliness. And we must respond. Do you know that if you're sitting in a padded pew in an air-conditioned building with electric lights and amplified sound and people who love the Lord, you are blessed beyond measure in this world? Do you know how great that is compared to so much of the rest of the world that suffers in so many ways? We're blessed. God has provided for us this morning right here and in many other churches in and around our area and throughout this world. He's provided for us, and he continues to provide for us, not just as churches, but as individuals and as families. He is providing for us, but make no mistake, he requires, he commands, and he deserves our response. Well, what should our response be? Our response should be when he provides for us to serve him, to love him, to grow in him, to worship him, and to give all of our life to him. And you know what? During the life of Othniel, after God raised him up and brought deliverance from this evil king, that's what the people did. Problem was, they didn't keep doing it. Part of our response to God's provision in our life is to remember it. Not just to celebrate it in the moment. People of Israel were very good at celebrating God's deliverance in the moment that it happens. Maybe even for a few years after that. Maybe even a few dozen years after that in some cases. But eventually, they forgot. They forgot. We were talking in Sunday school this morning, a few of us, about why we don't share our faith. And sometimes it's because we forgot how powerful our salvation is. We've forgotten what God has done in our life. We've forgotten who we were before we gave our life to Christ and who He has made us since then. And it's easy for us, and this is where this cycle plays out in our life, it's easy for us to live a life. Maybe we go to church every Sunday. Maybe we go and we give a lot of money. Maybe we serve a lot. Maybe we're preachers. Maybe we're Sunday school teachers. Whatever we may be, we do all these things, but somehow, some way, our mind and then eventually our heart gets away from understanding the power of our salvation. Part of our response, one of the biggest parts of our response, is to remember God's provision. When we start to look for other people to provide for us, when we let ourselves provide for us, we get into trouble. God provides, and we must respond. We get into a little bit longer story, and you'll see here in just a minute, if you've read through the book of Judges, you're already aware of this, that some of the stories of the judges are longer, and some of the stories of the judges are shorter, and we're going to give you a couple examples of those right now. As we read in Judges 3:15, it says, "Again, the Israelites cried out to the Lord, and He gave them a deliverer, Ehud." And is that anybody's middle name in here this morning? No Ehud Jenkins or anybody in here? No? Okay. All right, Ehud. Man, what a name. That's one you can remember pretty easy. Ehud, a left-handed man, the son of Gera, the Benjamite. And the Israelites sent him with tribute to Eglon, king of Moab. Eglon is the king of this part of the cycle. He's the king of Moab, another foreign country, another foreign people that God has allowed to come in and oppress His people to bring them back to Him. Eglon is not the good guy in this story. Ehud has been brought up, and he's sent by God's people to bring a tribute. A tribute, of course, would have been monetary, it would have been possessions, it would have been tangible gifts, but it also was an honor gift to a king. In verse 16 it says, "Now Ehud had made a double-edged sword about a cubit long," it's about 18 inches or so, "which he strapped to his right thigh under his clothing. He presented the tribute to Eglon, king of Moab, who was a very fat man." Now, wait a minute. That just doesn't seem fair, does it? How would you like your name to go down for all of eternity in scripture of, as this is his name, and he was a very fat man? That hits home for some of us. I'm not really excited about that. But nonetheless, it plays in the story. How does it play in the story? Let's take a look at verse 18. "After Ehud had presented the tribute, he sent on their way those who had carried it." So we get the understanding, and usually this would have been the case with a tribute to a king. It took lots of people and lots of animals to carry this tribute. It was a big deal. They've come to celebrate, apparently, this king. So Ehud gives him the tribute, sends the people who carried it away. But, in verse 19, "on reaching the stone images near Gilgal, he himself, Ehud, went back to Eglon and said, 'Your Majesty, I have a secret message for you.' The king said to his attendants, 'Leave us,' and they all left." Here, he's given this tribute, he's gone on his way, he's come back. The king is sitting there thinking, man, he's got more good stuff to give to me. He's going to blow some more smoke. He's going to tell me how great I am some more. So he sends off all his people. So it's just Eglon and Ehud. Man, what great names, right? There in the throne room. Ehud then approached him. This is where he gets a little action movie oriented, so buckle up. Ehud then approached him while he was sitting alone in the upper room of his palace and said, "I have a message from God for you." As the king rose from his seat, can you imagine how that worked? This is about to be not only a blessing from these people, but a blessing of how great the king is from God himself. The king stands up in verse 21, it changes. Ehud reached with his left hand. Remember, he was left-handed. Drew the sword from his right thigh and plunged it into the king's belly. This is the part where that fat part kind of really plays into it. Verse 22. "Even the handle sank in after the blade and his bowels discharged. Ehud did not pull the sword out and the fat closed in over it." Why such detail? Boy, they are really laying it on thick for poor old Eglon, aren't they? Eglon, or however you want to pronounce his name. Well, here's how it plays out that way. Here's why that detail is described. It says, "Then," verse 23, "Ehud went out to the porch. He shut the doors of the upper room behind him, and he locked them." part we won't read this morning just for the sake of time, tells us that Ehud gets away. And the king's people have been sent away by the king. You didn't dare violate the order of the king and show back up before he was ready for you. So Eglon is still in there dead, right? He's been killed by this person who's come in to pay tribute and has turned on him. And it takes a while before Eglon's people miss him. And at first they think, Scripture tells us, that maybe he's just seeing a man about a dog. Maybe he's in the bathroom. And so they wait and they wait. Finally they realize something's going on. And they come in. They don't even necessarily realize he's dead because the sword has gone all the way into his body. The fat's covered it up. Pretty good advertisement for Weight Watchers, actually, if you think about it. But it disguises what's happened. And so that gives Ehud even longer to get away. And sure enough, this is part of the way that God delivers the people through the judge, Ehud. You say, that's a weird story. Can you say that in 2021? I mean, isn't that offensive to fat people and sword makers and people with bathrooms and all kinds of other things? Well, who knows? Maybe so. But it's the way in real life that God delivered his people this time. You know what the problem with Eglon was? At least in this episode, at least in this moment where he died, he was real caught up in the idea that people were telling him how great he was. We learn through this, as God raises up this judge Ehud to deliver his people in this situation, we learn we cannot trust our own achievements. We can't trust our own achievements. We better not trust our own achievements, because Eglon is in this story as this king who's having success and who's being rained upon with praise. And then all of a sudden, things turn very bad, very quickly. In the midst of him sitting up to hear how great he thinks God has said he is, and being so excited about his own achievements, this evil king meets his end. Doesn't that happen to us too? When we get real proud of all we've done. What does Scripture tell us? Pride comes before what? More success? No, a fall. The minute we get so caught up with all we are and all we've done, get ready. The minute we stop giving glory to God and start taking glory for ourselves, get ready, because things are about to start falling apart. If you're not sure of how that plays out in 2021, just read the news. Take a look at any type of documentary about someone famous who is fallen so poorly. Whatever the movement, Me Too, all those type of stuff, the stuff in politics, all kinds of things, there's plenty of fall stories out there. And pride's been involved in every single one of them. We can't get puffed up about our own achievements. Isn't that what the Israelites kind of did in this cycle of events every time? Didn't they get to a good place because God had brought them there? And they said, oh, look at us. We're blessed. We're God's people. We're on his side. We can do whatever we want. And what would end up happening next? The fall. They'd forget about God. They'd live in their own power and their own achievements and their own accomplishments and their own greatness and glory. And they'd forget about who was the one who ever gave them all good things. And then it'd get bad pretty quick. Now, Ehud's story is a fairly detailed one, even down to, you know, overweightness of the king and the sword's length and all the whole details, right? It's a pretty detailed story. But not all of the stories of the judges are that way. We hear about next in Judges 3:31, a judge that we literally only get one bit of information about. In Judges 3:31, we read, after Ehud came Shamgar, son of Anath, who struck down 600 Philistines with an ox goad. He too saved Israel. And that's all we get about Shamgar. We get a little reference to him a couple chapters later, but not any more information about him. Just a retelling of what he did. So what did he do? He was a judge that God also raised up as part of this cycle. And with an ox goad, which is kind of like a long cattle prod for oxen that they would use to plow the fields and to move, you know, move things and goods and livestock. And with that, we don't know if he killed 600 in one shot. We don't know if he killed 600 over a long period of time. We just know that with this very rudimentary and basic weapon, or really not even weapon, tool, God used it to deliver his people from 600 evil oppressors. He too saved Israel. You know, we were talking again, like I said, in Sunday school about sharing our faith. And, you know, sometimes when we talk about sharing our faith, we might be people who have been in church all of our life. And we might think, well, I mean, I don't have a real flashy story. Now, you know, I didn't get saved with, you know, a drug needle hanging out of my arm or living on the streets or after murdering someone and being in prison or, you know, whatever we might think would be a big flashy testimony. I think in the story of Shamgar, as we look through the book of Judges, we get reminded that sometimes it can be pretty simple, and it's nonetheless powerful. It's no less powerful when God does something simply. In fact, in our lives, in our salvation, in God's work in us, God's power makes it simple. If you had 600 men versus one man, and you said, hey, you know what? We're going to give the one guy an ox goad. Nobody would say, oh, well, then now it's going to be a fair fight. Now it's going to be even. He should probably win, that one guy. He's got an ox goad, for crying out loud. He can do this, right? No, he'd still be overwhelmingly outnumbered, outmanned, outpowered. Yet through God's power, that simple ox goad brings victory. Would it have brought victory without God's power? Nope. He might have made it through one or two, not 600. Sometimes in our lives today, we feel like we're pretty outnumbered, don't we? Sometimes we feel like maybe we're outnumbered by the people who we think are against us. And maybe they are against us. Sometimes we feel like we're outnumbered by the situations and the circumstances we find. Sometimes we're outnumbered by a diagnosis or a revelation of some truth in our life that's been hidden. Devastating news. Sometimes, probably most of the time for most of us, we're just simply outnumbered by how bad we know we have been. How far from God we know we have wandered. We ask that question, well, how could God still love me? That outnumberedness feels like a lot more than 1 to 600 men a lot of times. A lot of times it drives us into the depths of depression, despair, hopelessness. But God comes, just like he delivered his people, just like Shamgar too saved Israel, God, through Christ, brings salvation and redemption, even our moments of feeling outnumbered. God's power makes it simple. Only he can do it, and therefore only he will do it. And no matter how hard we try to do it for ourselves or try to do it for somebody else, we can't do it, but he can and he does. And when he does move in his power, just like with that one ox goad and that one man, he upends even the most drastic of odds. He brings upsets, the likes of which college football has never seen. He delivers out of his power, and sometimes he makes it just that simple. If we'll follow him, he'll work in our lives. Why? Why do we make it so much more complicated so often? Why do we find ways to say, oh, yeah, but, or, well, the last time, or I heard, or I read, or I saw? This morning, God's power can make the outrageously oppressive fall, very simply. He can do it in your life. Many of you know exactly what I'm talking about because he's already done it in your life. You've seen, against all odds, God bring victory in your life. You've seen, against all the things you know about you, him still love you and be faithful to you and deliver you. You've seen what being faithful to him brings in your life. The joy, the opportunity, the blessing, the ministry and the service. If that's you this morning, praise the Lord this morning. We praise him with you that he has worked in massive and powerful ways in you. Maybe this morning there's someone here. Maybe there's more than just one someone who's standing there facing these outrageous odds against them. You feel outnumbered. Know that the God who delivered through these judges in some very weird ways to us delivers in a magnificent way today. He delivers in a way of sending his own son to die on the cross, just like we talked about during the baptism time. To die on the cross for you, for you. Not just for everybody else and you just kind of get included in there, for you. And he didn't stay dead. After being the one and only sufficient sacrifice to atone for your sin and for mine, he rose up out of the grave. And he continued to appear to his disciples over a period of weeks and taught them and reminded them and let them catch on to what he actually had been doing all along, just like he continues to teach us. And then he ascended up into heaven, and he's waiting to come back. Whatever odds you think you're up against, he's already beat them. He's already conquered whatever oppressive kings might be in your life. He's already done the work to deliver you, and all he calls you and I to do to be a part of his salvation is to simply say, God, I'm yours. I believe that Jesus is who the Scriptures say he is. I believe that I am who the Scriptures say I am, and I give my life to you. Be my Savior, forgive me, rescue me, redeem me, and now I'm yours. Use me in whatever way you see fit. There's a lot of folks sitting next to you this morning who have done that and who are doing that. If you've not experienced that this morning, I encourage you, don't wait another second. In our time of invitation in just a moment, would you give your life to Christ? Would you experience the joy and salvation that comes only and singularly through salvation through Jesus? Maybe this morning you are saved. You know you are. You know you've given your life to Christ, but you're kind of in that part of the cycle where you rebel a little bit, or maybe a lot. Know that God is but a prayer away from delivering you all over again, from renewing your mind, renewing your heart, renewing your commitment, putting you right back on path to serve him and glorify him greatly. If that's you this morning, then the invitation to you, the question, the offer from God is simply this: come back. Come back. Remember who God is. See if he doesn't show himself to be even greater than you remember. Let's pray together. God in heaven, we thank you, Lord, that you are our heavenly Father. We thank you, Lord, that you love us in ways that we don't fully comprehend, but today we know you love us in ways, and we believe that you love us in ways that conquer every foe that we'll ever come against. Lord, we praise you for that today. For those of us that know you as our Savior and Lord, thank you, Father, for Jesus Christ. For those who today you're saying it's time, now, don't put it off anymore. Give your life to Christ. I pray, Lord, that you would give them boldness, that you would conquer every bit of fear right now in their life that would tell them reasons why from our enemy not to do it, and Lord, that you would break down all those walls and deliver them today into salvation and into life eternal in Christ Jesus. Father, for those of us who know your salvation but who wander from it more times than we'd like to admit, Father, draw us back to you. Whatever it is you want to do in our hearts, Lord God, you work as only you can. We'll give you all the glory for it now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Please stand. I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. The path of sin too long I've tried. Lord, I'm coming home. Coming home. Coming home. Never more to roam. Open wide thine arms of love. Lord, I'm coming home.
Amen. Please be seated for just another few moments. Just wanted to give you a few things, a few pieces of information, and a couple things hopefully that you're going to be excited about and be blessed by. Our ministry spotlight this morning is to remind you, if you're serving on any of our committees, that we do have the first of two offerings of our all-committee meeting for this church year. That'll start, the first one is at 5 o'clock this evening. We'll do it right here in the sanctuary. It'll go about 45 minutes or so. It won't even go all the way till 6. But if you're serving on our community, it'll be a great time of hopefully encouragement and information for you to serve well in our church here, this church here. If you can't make it tonight, that's totally okay. Life happens. We have another offering of the exact same meeting. You can come after prayer meeting this coming Wednesday, 7:15, and we'll do it right here, and we'll be have you out of here by 8. So it's the same meeting each time. Whichever one is best for you, come be a part. If you want to do it twice, come on. That's fine, too. Also, we're excited to have this week our Wednesday night meal. It's time for the Holy Smokes Barbecue food truck to come back with us. This time we're doing it a little different, hopefully to make it even more convenient for you and your family this coming Wednesday night. October the 13th, which is this Wednesday, there's an order sheet right back here in the Welcome Center. And these pre-orders, last time we did it just so they know kind of how many to cook, these are now your actual pre-orders. So when you put your name at the bottom, they're going to have an order ready for you of whatever's on this sheet. There's several different entrees that you can pick from, and then the choice of sides are underneath each one. The prices are out beside, and you can pay when you get here on Wednesday. We also are going to start serving that evening, Wednesday evening, at 5 o'clock instead of 5:30. Hopefully to get you a little quicker through there between the pre-orders, starting a little earlier. Hopefully that'll make it a little bit smoother. We really enjoyed having the Wells come out and serve us and just bring us some great food. If you didn't get to be with us last time, come on out. If you will, just fill out your order sheet. If you want to take it with you home today and bring it back this evening, that's fine. But we need to have it in by this evening. You can try to text us Monday if it lingers on that long. But we want to get these to them as quick as we can so they can prepare and serve us well. If you want to fill it out this morning before you go so you don't forget about it, you can just fill it out and leave it right there on the Welcome Center table, and we'll take all the completed order forms and get those to the Holy Smokes folks, okay? Also, it's October, and it's time for a lot of great festivities and all kinds of celebrations throughout our area right here, our community. We do have Candy Lane coming up, and that's going to be on October 30th, the Saturday, last Saturday of this month. And so we'll have a table for as a church there, and we ask you to come and bring some candy for us to hand out. If you want to serve with us there, we'd love for you to do that and be there at the table with us. We're going to have a great time. We appreciate the folks that put that on for us here in our community for our kids to keep them from having to go so far from house to house as they get to go and be blessed and have a great time at Halloween. We'll also have our fall festival on Sunday evening, October 31st. So we will be here from 5 to 7. We'll have free food, free games, free prizes, and all kinds of things to do down in our Family Life Center and Fellowship Hall for you to be a part of. So we also, there's buckets in the Welcome Center and the Fellowship Hall for candy for both of those things. Just stick them all in the bucket and we'll put it all where it needs to go. So help us out with that. If you want to serve in those areas, let us know here in the office or talk to someone on the Hospitality Committee, Children's Committee, or Youth Committee, and we'll get you set up to serve. All right. We do have countywide renewal services going on. We want to invite you to. Appreciate Brother Johnny Sykes being here this morning. Good to see you, brother. And so that's coming up, not this week, but the next. And they must have been hard up for preachers because they asked me to come preach one service. So we're gonna have a great time worshiping with them. That'll be in various churches. If you'd like some information about that, please let us know. We'll be happy to share those locations and times and all the fun stuff that will go on with our countywide renewal services. Steele, did I miss anything?
If you're going to Winter Extreme, your first round of deposit is due right now. So either see me, I would say see Jason or Missy, but well, I don't see them, so see me. If you don't have it now, it's fine. Just see me tonight. So we just need a number because we have to do our deposits by this. We have to send our deposits off to them by Wednesday, so we need to know, like, now.
All right. Excited about that trip coming up over the New Year's holiday, Christmas, New Year's holiday. We're so glad you've been here with us this morning. We pray that God's blessed you. Shakers and movers. Shakers and movers. This Tuesday, 11 o'clock, Clay McPherson's going to be with us, and he may need a few extra CPR demonstrators to come out there, so he may just punch your chest a little bit, so just get ready. Grady, are you signing up for that? Going to be a great time. They're going to also have potluck as part of that. So lots of stuff coming up. Take a look at your bulletin. Most everything is in there. The rest of the stuff we'll tell you more about as soon as we possibly can. We love you, and we're so thankful. We hope you have a great rest of the day. Come back for that all-committee meeting tonight. There won't be any other activities on campus going on, and we look forward to seeing you. Steele, dismissed.
Please stand. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this thought. For I'm a part of the family. The family of God. Amen. Thank y'all.